Hello friends, myself Amar. In this video I will complete the user management app. Okay, now till now I have created a sign up form like this, which contains name, mobile, password and two buttons, save and reset. Up to this I have discussed in my previous videos. Okay, now what I will do is that, let me discuss what I have done here. I have created a class my app, which is extending the stateless widget, and in the overrided build method, what I have done, I have returned a material app having the title as user management app, and in the theme I have used the primary color as green and the accent color as yellow, and in the home attribute, what I have done, I am calling a form named as add user form. Okay, now in the add user form I have written the code to design a screen like this, which I have discussed in my previous video, right? Let me discuss once more. Now here what I have done, here I have created a class add user form, which is extending the stateful widget, and in the create state method I have returned add user form state, which is nothing but a class which is extending the state of which class? Add user form class. Okay, now what is this database helper that I will discuss later on? Here what I will discuss is that, if you can see here, if I am not providing any values in the name, mobile and password field, and if I am clicking on the save button, then you can see it is validating the forms, it is checking whether all the fields has been filled up or not. Okay, now how to do this form validation in Flutter, that portion I will discuss first. Okay, and to do the validation, what I have done here, I have created a form key. To create the form key, we have used global key, which is taking form state. Okay, now with the help of this form key, we can identify a form. This means this form key is unique for each and every form in Flutter. Okay, and here I have created a boolean variable that is auto validate having the value as false, right? Now this thing's text editing controller that I have discussed in my previous video. Now let me move to body section. Okay, in the body section, what I have done to do the form validation, what I have done here, I have used form, and in the key attribute, what I have used, I have used the form key which I have created here, as you can see. Okay, and in the auto validate property, what I have used, I have used underscore auto validate. By default its value is false. This means first time when the screen will be launched, at that time the auto validate property will be false. This means these fields will not be validated when the first time the screen will be visible to the user. Okay, that's why here I have done auto validate as false. Okay, now here I have used text form field. Okay, in the previous video, if you have noticed, here I have used text field, but to do the form validation I have replaced it with text form field, right? And it has an attribute which is called as the validator. Here it is taking string value. This means the value entered in the text field will be stored in the variable value. Okay, here I am checking, if the value is empty, then it will return please enter name, otherwise it will return null. Okay, and it has one more property which is onSaved. In the onSaved it is taking a string value, and here I have written name equals to value. What is this name? Here if you can see, here I have created three variables, where name, password and mobile. Okay, if the form validation passes, means if the user provides all the values in the fields, then this onSaved method will be called, and the value entered in the corresponding text field will be stored in the name variable. This means the value entered in the name text field will be stored in the variable name. Similarly, for mobile number also, here we have used validator, and here I am checking if the value dot length, means if the length of the mobile number is less than 10, then it will display the message provide valid mobile number. Okay, And if the validation passes, then the mobile number which is stored in the value variable will be stored in the mobile variable, right? Similarly, for the password also I have done the same thing. If the value is empty, then it will return enter password, and if the validation passes, then the password will be stored in the variable password, right? And here if you can see in this button, that is on the save button, here in the onPressed attribute I have written if underscore form key, this is the key which I have created at the beginning, it is checking by using the validate method that all the validation passes or not. If all the validation passes, then here I am using form key dot current state dot save. Whenever this save method will be called, then what will happen, this onSaved for each and every text field will be called, and the value entered in name, mobile and password will be stored in the variable name, mobile and password, right? And if the validation fails, then what will happen, in the else portion here I have used set state auto validate equals to true. Now as I discussed, for the first time when the form will open, at that time the auto validate will be false, but once the form is opened or it is visible to the user, after that if the validation fails, then the auto validate will become true. This means next time onwards the validation will happen automatically. Let me show you. As you can see, the form is visible to the user. Now suppose in the name field I am writing, suppose some text I am writing. Now as soon as we will start typing here, see, now the validation error automatically goes. Why? Because in the else portion here I have done auto validate equals to true. This means now the validation will be checked automatically whether you are clicking on the save button or not. This means if I remove this, then see, again it is checking the field. That is the functionality of using this auto validate. Okay. Now this is how the form validation happens in Flutter. Now next portion what I will discuss is that I will perform the entire CRUD operation, means the name, mobile number and the password entered by the user. Whenever the user will click on the save button, then those values will be saved in a SQLite database. I will show you how to save the values, how to retrieve the values from the SQLite database, how to perform update and delete operation in the SQLite database by using Flutter. Okay, now let me discuss the things one by one. Now to perform the CRUD operation, that is how to update, insert and delete by using SQLite in Flutter, we need to use some plugins which I have used here, that is SQLite, path provider and internationalization. This path provider will be used to specify the location of the database in your Android or iOS phone, and this INTL, that is internationalization plugin, we need to use to do some parsing. Okay, you can use the latest version. At the time of recording this video, the latest version is 0.1.15.7. okay, now after specifying these informations here, what I will do is that I will create a model class named as user. As you can see here, user.dart. Okay, because in SQLite the information will be stored as a table, and the table will contain four columns, that is ID, name, mobile and password. The value entered by the user will be stored as a row in the SQLite database. Okay, and to specify the columns, what I have done here, I have created a integer variable named as ID, and I have created name, mobile and password variable having the data type as string, right? After that I have created a constructor here, user, with the parameters name, mobile and password, and here I have created a named constructor having the values as, having the parameter as ID, name, mobile and password. Okay, after that here I have created some getter methods for ID, name, mobile and password, and I have created setter methods for name, mobile and password. Okay, now in SQLite database the value will be always stored as a map. Okay, and in the Flutter the value will be always displayed as an object, right? So what I have done here, I have created a method to map. What it will do, it will convert the user object to the map. Now you can see in this toMap method, what I have done here, I have created an object of map, and here I have written string and dynamic. Now what is this string? This string is used to specify what will be the data type of the key, because you know in map the value is stored as a key value pair. So this string specifies the data type of the key, and this dynamic specifies the data type of the value. Here I have written dynamic such that it can take any value. Like in Java we can use object to store any data type. Similarly in Flutter or in Dart, what we can do, we can use dynamic such that it can take any data type, right? Now here I have done, if id is not equals to null, then in the map, in the id key, what will be stored, the value of the id variable will be stored. Similarly in the map name, mobile and password, the values of name, mobile and password properties will be stored. Okay, now as I told you that in SQLite the value will be stored as a map, but whenever we need to display it to the user, then it must be converted to the Dart or Flutter object. Okay, and to do that, to conversion or to do the conversion, what I have done here, I have created a method from map, user dot from map. Okay, and here what I have done, from the map keys I am reading the value and I am storing it to the id, name, mobile and password. As you can see, map id, this means I am reading the value from the id key from the map and I am storing it to the id variable, and so on. Okay, this is how we can create the user model. You can see the code, right? Now once you do this, let me close this also. After that, what I will do, I will create a helper class named as database helper. Okay, now here what I have done, here I have created a static database helper and here I have created a static database object. Okay, and here I have created some variables. As you can see, user table, call id, call name, call mobile, call password, these are nothing but the column names. The table which will be created, it will contain the columns id, name, password, sorry, mobile and password. And what will be the name of the table? The name of the table will be user table, right? Now here I am creating a named constructor having the name as create instance. Okay, now here what I have done, here I have created another constructor, database helper, with the factory keyword. If you are using the factory keyword, this means with that constructor we can return some values. Now here if you can check, here if you can see, I have written if database helper equals to null, then database helper equals to database helper dot create instance. This means the database helper object will be created if and only if the database helper equals to null. This means the object of the database helper will be created only once in the entire Flutter object. Now that type of class is called as the singleton class. This means here I have created the database helper object as singleton. Okay, now next you can see here what I have done, here I have created a getter method for the database, and here we have used future. Now what is this future, async and await? These are the purely concept of Dart. Let me discuss this. In case of, if you know Android, in case of Android what happens, Android supports multi-threaded programming model. This means in Android we have one thread that is called as the main thread. In the main thread we can perform operations which takes a small amount of time, like we can perform some addition operation, we can perform some mathematical operations. Okay, but if we want to perform some operation which takes longer time, like if you want to download a file from the server, if you want to upload the file to the server, at that time we cannot block the UI, we cannot use the main thread to perform the operation, your app may crash. Okay, to solve that, what we can do, we can create a background thread or a worker thread, and we can perform the long running operation by using the background thread or the worker thread. Okay, but Dart is a single threaded programming model, supports Dart supports single threaded programming model. This means we cannot create any other thread, all the operations we need to do in the main thread itself. Okay, and to support or to perform the long running operations in Dart, it provides future, async and await API. Okay, let me discuss this here. If you can see, this is a main function. Here I have created a function display database content, and I have created another function read database content. Okay, now all these functions will work by using the main thread only, right? Now this read database content will perform a long running operation because it will read the value from the database. Sorry. And here what I have done, here I am using future.delay. This means here I am using a dummy parameter such that this function will take 10 seconds of time to operate. Okay, and after the operation what it will do, it will return the value as database content. Okay, and this read database content function I am using, where I am using or I am calling this function from the display database content. As you can see, I am calling this function here. Okay, now since this function will take some time to operate, that's why what we have done here, we have used future. This means in the future it will return data of what type? Of string type. And when we will call this function, then it should wait until it returns the data. And to do that, we need to use await. Okay, and whenever we are using await, we must use async. Okay, and once we call this function, what type of value it will return? It will return a future string. But when the value is returned, actually at that time it is not future, it will return purely string value. That's why here we have used string result. Now if you want more clarification on this future, await and async, you can consult any good Dart tutorial. Okay, now here what we have done, here we have created a getter method database, and here we have written database equals to null. This means if this database equals to null, then only this initialize database function will be called. Okay, and what this initialize database function is doing now, what it is doing, that it will create the database for us, that is user.db. okay, where it will create that path we will get by using this get application document directory function. Okay, and the entire path will be stored in the variable path, right? After that, here we have used the open database function, where we are passing the path, we are passing the version, and we in the onCreate method we are passing createDB. What this createDB will do? It will create the table for us. You can see the syntax here: create table, table name, and after that call ID. You can see the columns I have created here. Call ID, this means the column name will be ID, right? Here we are creating the columns as call ID, having the data type as integer, and the value of this call ID will be automatically generating starting from 1. Okay, after that we have call name, call mobile, call password. Now here we have taken the data type for call name as text, for call mobile it is text, and for call password I have taken the data type as integer, right? Now here we have used a function get user map list. What it will do? It will retrieve the values from the database as a map. Okay, and to retrieve the values, we need to write some query. And to write the query, what I have done, I have written db.query. From which table we want to retrieve the value? User table. And it will be ordered by using name in the ascending order. Okay, to perform the insert operation, here we have created a insert user function. Okay, and to perform the insert operation, we need to use the insert function. In which table we want to insert the value? In the user table. And as I told you that in SQLite, the values must be stored as a map. That's why what will happen? We need to convert this user object to the map by using the toMap function, which I have created here. As you can see in the user.dart, if you remember, here we have created a function toMap which will convert the object to the map, and that function I am using here, user.toMap. This means the object will be converted to the map. And to perform the update operation, here we have written the update syntax like this, as you can see, right? And to perform the delete operation, here I have written the delete command. and how many values are there in that table. For that I have created a get count function, and to retrieve the user as a list, not as a map, here I have created a function get user list. Okay, this is the entire code. You just have a look, you will be able to understand, right? This is the entire code for the database helper class. You can see this is the entire code which I have written, right? Now in the add user form, if you remember, whenever the validation passes, this means the user has provided all the values, then I have called a function save user. Okay, let me move to the save user. Now in the save user function, what I have done, I have created the constructor of the user class. If you remember, the constructor of the user class was taking name, mobile and password. So whenever the user will click on the button, save button, at that time the save user function will be called. And what the save user function will do, in the save user function I have created the constructor of the user class which will take name, mobile and password. And if you remember, I told you if the validation passes, then the mobile, name and password, these variables will contain the value which has been provided by the user in the text fields. Okay, now to perform the insert operation, as I told you, in the database helper we have created a function that is insert user. Okay, that's why we are using this database helper dot insert user. This database helper object I have created here, you can see here I have created the object of the database helper class, and by using this object here, what I am doing, I am calling the insert user method. Okay, and in the insert user method, if you remember, it is taking a, if you see here, insert user function is taking the object of user type. That's why here I am passing user. Okay, and the value after performing the insert operation, the value of the result will be always greater than 0. So here I have checked, if it is not equals to 0, then what I am doing, I am calling so alert dialog function, and I am passing two parameters, one is the status, and here I am passing user saved successfully, else status problem saving user. And in the so alert dialog, here what I have done, here I am using alert dialog. Now how to create the alert dialog, this I have discussed in my previous video. Okay, now what this function will do, it will generate an alert dialog displaying the message either as user saved successfully or problem saving user. Okay, this is how we can save the user, right? Now after saving the user, we need to check the user list, and to display the user list, what I have done, you can see in the abbar section here I have used the action attribute, and in the action attribute, which is taking a widget array, here what I have done, I have taken icon button. In the icon button I have taken view list, and in the onPrest method, what I am using, I am calling a function so user list. Due to this icon button, you can see there will be an icon in the app bar. Let me show you. There will be an icon in the app bar, this one. Okay, now whenever I will click here, at that time what will happen, a function will be called which is called as the so user lists. Now what this so user list function will do, it will create or it will open another view where we can see the user list. Now this means we need to navigate from this screen to another screen. Now let me tell you, like in Android, whenever a screen opens to the user, that screen is called as the activity. Similarly in Flutter, the screen which is visible, which is open to the user, that is called as the route. Okay, And whenever a screen or a route is visible to the user or it is opened to the user, then it is stored in a stack. Okay, this means if we open a route in Flutter, it will be stored in the stack, and from that route if we move to another route, then that particular route will be stored in the stack. Let me write it here. Suppose we are opening a route named as A, this means it will be stored in the stack. Okay, now suppose from the route A we are navigating to the route B, this means again it will be stored in the stack. And you know the stack operates on which principle? LIFO principle, last in first out. Okay, this means whenever the user will press the back button, at that time the route B will be removed from the stack. Okay, when the user presses the back button, at that time the route B will be removed from the stack and the route A will be visible to the user. Okay, and to perform this routing operation, the Flutter provides a special type of widget which is called as navigator. Okay, now let me show you. Whenever I will call this show user list, then what this function will do, you can see navigator.push. We are using a special widget navigator to perform the routing operation. Here I have written navigator.push. It is taking the context, and here we have taken material page route builder context, and where we are calling new user list. This means this particular route will be called, this particular screen will be called, named as user list. Now let me move to the user list. This is the user list which I have created. Now let me show you the output first. If you click here, then see, this is the screen which is opened, and here I have already saved some values, so that particular user list is visible to us. Okay, and here it contains a delete button. Once we click on the delete, at that time it will be removed from here. Now let me show you. Click here. Now see, user deleted successfully. Now how to perform this operation, let me show you. Here I have created a class user list which is extending the stateful widget. Now I have created a state named as user list state. This user list is extending a state class of which form? User list form. Okay, here I have used the object of user. Here I have created a variable ID, name, mobile and password. Here we have used controllers. Now what is the functionality of controller that I have discussed in my previous videos also. I have created the object of the database helper class to perform database specific operation like insert, update, delete. Now here I have created object or list of user class, that is list of user named as LST user. Here I have created a variable count equals to 0. Now in the build method, what I have done, I have created the object of the list class by using LST user equals to LST user. This means this object will be created only once. And here I have called a function update list view. Now what this function will do, as you can see, this update list view function, I have initialized the database, and here I have called a function get user list which I have created in the database helper. If you remember, here I have created a class function get user list which will return all the users in the form of list, right? And here I have written this dot LST user equals to LST user and this dot count equals to LST user dot length. This means the list which we have created, it will contain all the user from the database, and it will contain, and the count variable will contain the number of users present in the SQLite database. Okay, that's why whenever we are calling, this means whenever I am clicking here, at that time the build method is being called. As you can see here, the build method is being called, and this build method is calling the update list view method, and this update list view method is retrieving all the users from the database. Okay, now we need to display the information of the users like this, and to do that, here what I have done, here I have created an app bar having the title as user list, and in the body here I have written get user list view. Okay, now in the get user list view method, what I have done, I have used text style theme, and in the return view, in the return I have used list view dot builder. Now how to create the list view, that I have discussed in my previous videos also, right? And in the item builder, what I have used, card having the color as white, elevation as 2.0, and in the child I have used list style. These things I have discussed already. Now in the leading section I have used a circle avatar having the background color is green, and in the child what I have used, text, and here I have written this dot lst user position. Okay, this is the position, means the it will take the value from the list, and I have used substring operation on the name variable lst user position dot name substring 0, 1. That's why the first letter of the name is displayed as a text in this circle avatar. Okay. And in the title I have written text. What it is displaying, it is displaying name, and in the subtitle it is displaying mobile, as you can see, right? Now in the trailing section, what I have taken, a delete icon. Now in the trailing section, the icon which we are taking, we cannot perform the tap operation directly here. To apply the tap operation, here we need to use gesture detector, and once you apply gesture detector, then we can perform the on tap operation. Now in the on tap operation, I am calling the delete function, and in the delete function I am passing two things. One is the context and the position of the and the user to which I want to perform the delete operation. Now in the delete method, you can see we are calling the delete user method from the database helper class, and I am passing the ID. Okay. Now if the delete operation is performed successfully, then the value of result will be greater than 0, and once it is greater than 0, then in the snack bar, now how to create the snack bar, that portion I have discussed already in my previous videos. In the snack bar you will be able to see the message user deleted successfully, right? And once the user is deleted successfully, we need to update the list view. That's why we are calling the update list view method here, right? Now this is how we can perform the delete operation. Now we need to see how to perform the update operation. To perform the update operation, what I have done here, once you click here, then you can see a dialog is generated having name, mobile number and password, right? Now once you change this and click on the update operation, update method, then these values will be updated. Okay. Now whenever we will click on the list, or whenever we will tap on the list, at that time the alert box should come like it is coming here. Okay, whenever I am tapping on the list, at that time this alert box is coming. And to do that, what I have done, in the on tap of the list view, I have generated a dialog, and in the dialog what I have done, I have used the content attribute. In the content I have used a row widget. In the children, which is taking a widget array, we have used expanded widget, and in the expanded as a child we have used column, and in the column in the children widget we have used text form field, and as a hint text we have used the name, and as a controller we have used name editing controller. Similarly for the mobile we have used this, and in the controller I have used mobile editing controller. Similarly for the password we have used this, and in the controller I have used password editing controller, right? And in the action we have taken two flat buttons, one is the cancel, and whenever we will click on the cancel button, at that time we have used navigator dot pop context. Now to push the route to the stack, we have used navigator dot push. Similarly to remove the route from the stack, we need to use the pop method. Okay, and here we have taken another button, that is update. Whenever we will click on the update button, at that time the value should be updated. Now whenever I will click on the update button, at that time the ID I have stored, means the user on which we are tapping, the ID of that user I have stored in the ID variable, and here I have checked if the name field is empty, then by default the name variable will contain the original value of the user. Similarly, the same checking I have made for mobile and password. And if the user is providing all values, then what will happen? The name, mobile and password will contain the values provided in the text field. Okay, here I have not done the validation, because that validation I have shown you in the first form. The same kind of validation you can apply here also. Okay, and here I have used user, means I am creating a constructor of the user class. If you remember, in the user I have used a named constructor with ID. The same constructor I am using here, and I am passing ID, name, mobile and password. Okay, and in the database helper I am calling the update user function. If you see here, the update user function I am calling, this update user function will update the user information. Okay, and once the user information is updated, then that box which is coming, that should be popped from the stack, and the update, and to update the list, where we have called the update list view method. Okay, this is how we can perform the update operation. And you can see the entire code. Let me show you once. This is the main, this is the model class user, this is the database helper class, where all the database specific operations are there. All the database specific operation lies in this database helper class. Okay, this is the add user form. This is the form which I have designed to do the entry portion, from where the user can enter their values. This is the form, you can check. This I have discussed in my first two tutorials, right, of the user management app portion. This is the entire code for the add user form. Okay, and this is the entire code for the user list, from where the user can see the details of all the users which has been created, and from here the users can update as well as the users can be deleted. Okay, this is the entire code, right. I hope you have liked my video. If you liked my video, please subscribe my channel. Thank you so much. Okay, in the upcoming Flutter I will create another project related to e-commerce. Okay, thank you so much.